Y'all ready?
9 o'clock.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to call the May 2nd, 2016 meeting of the County Commissioners to order. And before we start, if you'll please bow with me, I'll do the invocation. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for all the blessings you've given us. Thanks for this beautiful day to come out and just to feel your presence. And dear God, be with this board today as we undertake the county's business. Let us make right decisions. And Lord, be with our military, our law force and enforcement. Be with them every day. Just protect them, guard them, and look over them. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's do the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
I would sing.
Our first thing of order, I'm going to call on our sheriff. He has a presentation to make this morning.
Let me say, first of all, it's an honor to be here today. It's even more of an honor to help recognize Dan Eagle, who has served this county through the political process and in law enforcement positions in Alamance County for many, many years. I met Dan when I was about 16 years old. We played ball against each other, baseball, and I hate to say it, but they won that particular game. Of course, it was Little League, and they were driving cars. When Dan decided to retire from the Board of Commissioners, there's two people that shared the same sentiment that myself, my chief deputy, and they worked extremely hard through the governor's office to get Dan Eagle the Order of the Long Leaf Pine. And I would like Mr. and Ms. Washington to please stand up. I can tell you this, I would love to have Ms. Watkins as a detective because she will pursue everything. Dan, if you would, come up here.
First of all, many of you might not know Dan, but like I say, I've known Dan since I was 16 years old. There is nobody that I know of in this county that's got the integrity that you have, Dan Eagle.
Make sure.
And with that, I would read this, but I don't think I can. Dan has been a friend of mine. He's been a friend of this county. He's been a friend of the people. He works hard, and I assure you, he thinks he's going to get off. And I'm already jumping on him, trying to get him sworn back in. He was a detective with the Baltimore Police Department for several years where he and I lived together. Matter of fact, I thought our wives were going to file an alienation in effect. Because it was day and night. From there, he went to Elon, and my wife became his secretary. And she found out why he and I were gone all the time. I think that's the only reason she took the job. And then from there to our legislature, Board of Commissioners, and Chairman. And Dan Eagle, I know you have one of these. And the governor's office does not give two to just anybody. Hmm. Congratulations, friend.
Thank you. And thank you, Sheriff. Thank you, Ms. Watkins. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And I give thanks to Governor McCrory also. Thank you, for County Commissioners, for allowing this to be done here today. And this baseball, actually, that's a true story. He was for the most part. Let me explain.
For the most part.
He was a senior at Southern Alamance. I was a sophomore at Gibsonville. And we beat them over at Gibsonville. This was early in the season. That Southern Alamance went on and won the state championship that year. But I got the winning hit. So that was a true story. But
tell this crowd about how old the other players were.
Some of them on your team like you've been shaving 5 or 6 years. I just, again, thank you. It's very humbling, and I have one from Governor James Hunt, and I have one from Governor Pat McCrory, so Democrat and a Republican, and it kind of epitomizes what this board has done in working together to solve the problems here in the county. And you know, folks, when you look at the national level and the state level and the local level, 75% of the people, they want to see solutions done, and they want to see government working together, and that's what it's all about. But again, I thank you. I'm not going. I need to get off my stump and go sit down because you're a meeting run. But again, thank you for the pen. This was very nice, and thank you for the plaque, and I certainly appreciate it. Thank you, Sheriff. Appreciate it. Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'm going to stay and see my good friend Roger Parker this morning, and then
very
I'll be gone then.
Okay. Well, from the commissioners, thank you, Mr. Engel, for all you've done for us. It's been a real pleasure serving with you, and we will continue looking to you for some advice on occasion. So.
And it was a pleasure serving with each one of you.
Yes, thank you very much.
And hard-working board, and I thank you for all the hard work, and it was a joy. Thank you very much.
Very good.
Thank you, Dan.
Okay, very good. Our next order of business is Mr. Roger Parker, and I'm going to read a letter that came to us from the Republican Party. It's the official notice of a replacement vote in response to resignation of Commissioner Engel. The Alamance County Republican Party held an executive committee meeting to appoint a replacement to serve until December of this year. The executive committee selected Roger Parker of Mebane. I'm not going to give his full address. Everybody will be sending him a letter. to replace Mr. Engel. And the meeting was held on last Thursday at the historic courthouse in Graham. And with that, I am going to ask Tori to come up and do his oath with him. And I think he brought his own Bible with him.
K. Parker, do solemnly swear that I will maintain the laws of the United States.
And the Constitution and laws of North Carolina, not inconsistent therewith.
And the laws of the North Carolina, not inconsistent therewith.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
That I will faithfully discharge the duties of my office.
As County Commissioner.
As County Commissioner.
For the County of Alamance.
County of Alamance.
So help me God.
So help me God.
I, Roger Parker. Do swear.
Do swear.
That I will well and truly execute.
That I will well and truly execute.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of County Commissioner.
Of County Commissioner.
For the County of Alamance.
For the County of Alamance.
According to the best of my skill and ability.
According to the best of my skill and ability.
According to law.
According to law.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Roger, before you sit down, would you like to introduce your wife to the audience?
Yes, I would.
Okay.
As they say, behind every good man is a good woman. I don't know about being a good man, but I know I got a good woman. This is my wife. This is my wife, Phyllis, and she's behind me in everything I do. I couldn't do it without her. And also, thank you very much for everyone coming today. And I look forward to working with the board, and I hope in some small way I can make Alamance County a better place, a safer place to live and raise our families.
Very good. Now you can take your seat right beside me, sir.
Okay.
the board, and with that, I think they left you some pins, so you're now pinned.
Is that a fraternity pin or sorority pin?
No, that's an Alamance County pin. You're...
Oh, wonderful.
Yes. You can put it right above that American flag.
I got it.
Welcome. Welcome aboard.
Thank you very much.
All right. Our next order of business today will be the election of the chairman, and I am going to turn that over to our county manager, Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chairman Boswell. As everybody's aware, with the stepping down of Chairman Engel, we do have to do a reorganization at this time. So is there a nomination for chair?
I would like to make a nomination, and that would be Eddie Boswell.
I'll second it.
We have a nomination of Mr. Boswell for chair and a second by Ms. Massey. Is there any further nominations? All right, we'll take a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
All right.
Boswell,
thank
you.
You
are the chair.
And I will now take over again.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir. All right. Next order of business will be to nominate a vice chairman, and with that, I'll entertain a motion for that. I would like to nominate Mr. Bird. How about that? Can I hear a second on that?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, very good. Now we got to go to work. First thing we need to do is the approval of our agenda for today, and I'm hoping, Roger, you've had a chance to look at some of the items on that. Is there anything on our agenda that anybody would like to pull and discuss? Not hearing any, I will entertain a motion to approve our agenda for the day.
So moved.
Second?
Second. I'll second.
Linda's, thank you for the second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any in opposition? Thank you very much. All right. Public hearing. Here we go.
Did we do the consent agenda?
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, my bad. That's first day on the job. I get a little reprieve, right? Can we look at our consent agenda, and is there anything on that we need to discuss, pull, or look at otherwise?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Okay. And I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Thank you. All right, now we're going to move on to a public hearing. And with that, I will bring Ms. Libby Hodges, our planning director, up.
Thank you.
Thank you, Libby.
Good morning. We have requested to hold a public hearing today to hear any comments that the public may have about the planning board ordinance. We made some changes to clarify voting status, how to determine residency, clarify the responsibilities, and make sure we don't have conflicting rules and requirements for the board. This came about as a review of our board rules and the ordinance and making sure that we didn't have conflicting requirements between the two.
Hang on one sec. Tori, have you got a packet for Roger to have some of this information in it? Can you get him one? I feel like we're amiss by him not being able to see all the information. I have it on my iPad.
Yeah,
there you
thank you, sir.
All right.
I apologize.
That's something. I know it's a lot going on today, so excuse us for our inefficiencies.
We apologize.
I got you. Okay, very good. So I'm sorry, Libby.
That's okay.
Yep.
It's just fine.
All right, proceed on.
That's really all I have to
say. Okay. Well, with that, I guess we need to open it up for a public hearing. Do I hear a motion?
Oh, I so move.
Okay, Bob, thank you. And
I'll
Linda second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. With that, I'm going to go across. We'll start on this side of the room. If there's anyone that has anything they'd like to say about this change in our structuring, basically, is what we're doing for the planning board, feel free to speak up. Tony, okay.
One of the things that I've noticed about this planning board is there appears that nobody on that board has been sworn, took an oath. Is this true?
I will defer to our county attorney. I think by the commissioner's appointment to that is basically that appointment for them.
But there's no oath.
Not required by statute.
Yeah, okay.
To me, with things that have gone on in the past, especially with these ordinance enforcement schemes, that there should be an oath of office because these people are making life-changing decisions. They're also sending recommendations to the Board of Commissioners in reference to constitutionality of ordinances. So for a bunch of people just to, you know, be able to get into our lives as they have done in the past. Dan Engel made a comment about we all want to see government work well. I do. That's all I want. I want to see government work well for everybody. Period. Not a bunch of thugs. And I think a oath for a planning board member is, might not be the law, but hey, it threw a little bit of integrity in there.
Mr. Chairman, the oath, the planning board decisions are directly appealable to the Board of Commissioners.
Exactly. Yeah, it's really to us, and we are under oath to withhold the law as we make decisions. Okay, do I hear anybody else from this side of the room that would like to speak to that? Last chance. With that, then, I will ask for a nomination to close the public hearing.
I move that we close the public hearing.
Second.
And second, thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? I don't hear any. With that, I guess we're pretty well done with that, and now we need to make a
motion
to approve the amendment as done.
Can I ask one question?
Certainly.
Were there any change? All this came before this board before. Have there been any changes since we last reviewed it?
No.
But basically, it was just stating the membership of that board is what this reorganization was.
Right, and it was moving a few things over into the bylaws that don't need to be in the ordinance, like meeting dates and times that we would be able to change without the board having to.
Right.
Or having it set in the ordinance.
More of a structure thing for her to be able to run the board as she needs to.
And had you gotten any comments from the public?
No, sir.
Okay. Very good. I guess that's it. Any more questions, comments? Linda, you got any? All right. With that, I'll take a motion then to approve this as presented.
I move.
Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. And second by Roger. All in favor?
Aye. Uh-huh.
All opposed? Hearing none. Okay. Well, the next order of business, we have several recognitions that we're going to make this morning, and I'm going to come down to the podium. And number one on our list today is the SOAR Quarterly Recognition. And I don't know who's here to represent.
She's here.
Okay. Very good. Rose Davis. Is that you? I don't lie. Rose, thank you for all you do for Alamance County. The SOAR Award is done because she exemplifies what our county employees do. And I'm sure she probably has some folks that work with her here that could testify to that. And anyhow, Rose, on behalf of the commissioners, this is presented to you in recognition of your nomination for the Employee Excellence during the first quarter of the year 2015 and 16. With that, thank you very much, Rose,
you.
For your hard work. And would you like to say anything?
It's just for serving, and serving is something I do in all aspects of my life. And I got it for doing something I love to do.
Well, good. And we thank you very much for that.
Right, thank you.
All right, next we have a proclamation for the Food Allergy Awareness Week. Would you like to
read the paper yesterday, didn't I? Would you like to introduce yourself to
folks? I would. For those of you I don't know, my name is David Stevens. I'm an attorney here in Alamance County. More importantly, the reason I'm here before you today is I'm also a parent of a child who has a food allergy, and I find myself educating myself like all parents do for things you don't know, and I've come to realize that there is a gap of missing information in Alamance County regarding food allergies, and I felt it incumbent upon myself to teach my child to advocate for herself and to take on this responsibility, and this is just one step in that process. So I appreciate being here for you today. I appreciate Mr. Boswell with the recognition, with the proclamation. And again, what I'll say to you is just, if you have not educated yourself, please do so. It is 1 in 13 children now have food allergies. These are not allergies like seasonal allergies. They are allergies that can take their lives with anaphylaxis. And what I've come to realize is that as parents of children with food allergies, we know a lot about it. It's the parents of the children who interact with those children that information maybe is missing. Very easy to educate yourself, www.foodallergyweek.org. Next week is the recognition week, and that's the reason I'm wearing a teal pin. And the Children's Museum will actually have an event next Saturday, free admission for children, basically for the purposes of educating parents and our children. So, thank you.
David, thank you for that. And with that, I will read this. Whereas as many as 15 million Americans have food allergies, nearly 6 million are children under the age of 18. And whereas research shows that the prevalence of food allergy is increasing among children, whereas 8 foods cause the majority of all food allergy reactions in the U.S., those being shellfish, fish, milk, eggs, tree nuts, peanuts, soy, and wheat. Whereas symptoms of a food allergic reaction can be subtle or severe and can include hives, vomiting, respiratory distress, and swelling of the throat. Whereas, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, food allergy results in more than 200,000 ambulatory care visits a year involving children under 18. Reactions typically occur when an individual unknowingly eats a food containing an ingredient to which they are allergic. Whereas, it is very likely that school-aged children and parents of school-aged children will be involved with and interact with children who have food allergies. Whereas there is no cure for food allergy and scientists do not understand why, strict avoidance of the offending food is the only way to prevent an allergic reaction. Whereas anaphylaxis is a serious allergic reaction that is rapid in onset and may cause death. Whereas education and information is made available by organizations such as the Food Allergy Research and Education, that's the FAIR, a national nonprofit organization dedicated to improving the quality of life and the health of individuals with food allergies and to provide them hope through the promise of new treatments. Now therefore be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim May 8th through 14th, 2016 Food Allergy Awareness Week in Alamance County, and we encourage the residents of the county to increase their understanding and awareness of food allergies and anaphylaxis by visiting foodallergyweek.org. David, thank you. It's a pleasure seeing you. David and I work with the home builders a lot together, so we're familiar with each other. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And next in our proclamations today, and I didn't ride my motorcycle today, but I'm going to bring some guys who did up. Would you guys come up tonight? You can introduce yourself there if you will. That'd be great.
How y'all doing today? My name is David Blum. I'm the president of the Alamance chapter of the Concerned Bikers Association. We are a legislative organization that lobbies our politicians in Raleigh for fair and just laws that protect us when we ride our motorcycles. and not just all motorcycles throughout the entire state of North Carolina.
And with him is my cousin, Gene Boswell.
Good morning.
All right. Well, on behalf of the commissioners, we would like to recognize this proclamation for Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month. And in that, whereas motorcycle riding is a popular form of recreation and transportation for thousands of citizens across North Carolina and the United States. Whereas North Carolina has over 193,000 registered motorcycles and over 400,000 licensed drivers for the DMV who have either a motorcycle endorsement or a motorcycle learner's permit. Whereas it is important that the citizens of North Carolina be aware of motorcycles on our roadways and recognize the importance of motorcycle safety and sharing the roads. Whereas the safe operation of a motorcycle is enhanced through a combination of rider trainer and experience, good judgment, knowledge of traffic laws, and licensing requirements. Whereas several organizations, such as the Alamance County Concerned Bikers Association, along with the North Carolina Motorcycle Safety Education Program, and other state and local motorcycle clubs and riding social clubs are committed to increasing the safe operations of motorcycles by promoting rider safety education programs. Whereas Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month is designed to increase public awareness about motorcycles and to encourage their safe and proper use among motorcycle riders. Now therefore, be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim the month of May 2016 as Motorcycle Safety Awareness Month in Alamance County, and urge all citizens to call this observant to attention of all our citizens. And Dave said they're going to have a fundraiser event.
We're actually doing our annual Motorcycle Safety Awareness Ride this coming Saturday. We'll be leaving out from down home Harley-Davidson at 10:30. It'll be a nice 2.5 hour ride out through Snow Camp, Cyber City, Liberty. We'll stop for lunch in Liberty, and then we'll come back through Julian and end up on the other side of Gibsonville. And it's nice scenic country, two lane roads, and it's basically to promote safety and awareness along the motorcycle.
Yeah, we're at a slight disadvantage when we ride out there and you got a big car and a smaller motorcycle.
Yes, so we
please watch
that. Look twice, save a life. There
twice,
you go. We have
it.
A saying, look twice, save a life.
Well, with that, I'd like to give you this.
Bob, thank
well,
you very
thank
much. Thank you very much, sir.
Uh-huh. Very good.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. All right. Here, thank you all. All right, next on our agenda today, we have the ABSS funding request, and I'm guessing, Jay, are you speaking to that for us?
Dr. Thorpe got in touch with me. He's tied up in the meeting at Vaughan Road. He asked me to do the presentation for the money that we will be returning to the county that we did not use last year on some of the projects that we did. And then from there, we'll go into the lottery fund request that we have for this year. The only change in that part will be on the transportation where it says replace the fuel tank monitoring system. The lottery will not pay for that because all the money has to be used on school property and not bus garages and stuff like that.
Okay.
And in the back page is the rest of the list that we will be doing, along with the bond funding request for 5 mobile units.
Okay. Any questions to Jay on this issue?
I have a couple of questions. Is Susan? There you are. So you're requesting $15,000 less than what's on the sheet. And then the, can you advise us on the total amount available currently for both the lottery and the bond?
I do not have the lottery amount with me today, but they do have sufficient funds in the lottery funds right now. They haven't had big drawdowns throughout the year, right. So we've had our first and second quarter deposit. With the school system, they have to do their projects in the summer, so at this point in time is when they bring most of the requests to us. But they do have ample funding, and I can get you that figure.
Well, I just wanted to make sure. I just kind of want to get an idea, you know, just for, not just for me, but so everybody else knows.
Right, that's a good idea.
And then on the bond money?
For the bond money, there is currently around $800,000 of bond interest that we do need to spend, so this is a wonderful way to expend those funds.
Well, I know all these things are necessary and very needed projects.
Right. Yes, we have a lot of needs in our school that we need to address. Anybody else? You got any questions? Roger, any questions on that? All right. With that, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
I'll so move.
I'll second it.
Linda, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you. Thank you, Jay. I appreciate it. Coming before us and tell Dr. Thorpe he got off easy.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Paycheck. All right. Next order of business is the resolution for the issuance of general obligation community college bond series 2016, and I see Ms. Susan Roberts is going to tell us all about that.
Yes. Good morning, commissioners. This is the final resolution that we need the Board of Commissioners to pass that will allow us to fully issue for the general obligation community college bond series 2016 in the amount of $15 million. We have currently been working with the LGC to finalize our official statement. We are scheduled, pending the approval of this resolution, to go to market on May the 24th, and we would close out on those bonds on June 14th. So if anyone has any questions, I'll be glad to entertain them at this time.
So I guess we don't know what the interest rate will be until the date of closing?
Exactly. I did talk to Gordon Johnson last week when we were having a phone conversation concerning the official statement, and they had a similar bond sale, and that sale went around 2%. So he said that interest rates right now are great, and he really feels like that the market will stay strong for when this sale occurs.
And that's somewhat based on our bond rating?
Yes, sir.
And was the 2% organization rated about the same as we?
Yes.
So our bond rating is getting better.
Exactly.
I was going to say more better. That's not probably.
It's probably something to do with our fund balance.
It does. There's strength in that, yeah. In that when you have an investor to look, then they know that Alamance County has a strong market, whether it be economically or that we're making the right decisions to add to our fund balance so that we can sustain our day-to-day operations.
Which in the long run is a less cost to the county residents and
yes, sir.
What we have to pay out for these obligations.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Well, we're reading through these documents. I mean, this is full of a lot of legalese that's kind of above my skill set. So I'm assuming that our county attorney, Mr. Albright, has reviewed all of this. And
yes, sir. Looked at it in 2012 with our bond counsel. At that time, we didn't have a funding mechanism because the sales tax referendum did not pass. But this has a life of 4 years, so we're approaching the end of the life of the bond issue. Yes, it's a standard. The standard language that you need to make the bonds marketable.
Thank you.
Any other questions about it, Roger? I think they're counting on this because I got a notice of groundbreaking coming at May 17th or something.
Yes, sir, 2:30. Mr. Parker, we'll make sure we're going to fill that calendar up. So
you thought you were going on vacation, didn't you? Okay, very good. I'll entertain a motion to approve it. So be.
I'll make the motion to approve it.
I'll second.
Second. Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposition heard. Thank you very much, Susan.
You're welcome. And I think I have the next couple agenda items.
You're the lottery fund application. I've got my application right now.
Yes, sir. What we are asking is for the permission to file this application in the amount of $457,006.38. This will be the debt service portion of the Career Tech Center, per the memorandum of understanding that we have with the school board, was that the county would appropriate $130,000 each year to go toward the Career Tech Center, with the remaining amounts coming from their lottery funds.
So we're just taking the lottery allocations.
Yes, sir.
And supplementing what we're doing.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and we're working very hard, I think, with our legislators to bring more money back out of the lottery that was told we would get a long time ago, so.
We're hoping the governor doesn't have plans to spend it all.
It looks like he may have a few.
He has a few plans, but we're hoping that we can put the money back in facilities and capital items like the lottery.
And I think that's a much needed thing for not only our school system, but a lot of others across the state.
So this lottery allocation plus the one we just approved is still below what we have?
Yes.
All right. Any other questions, discussion? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion. I'll make a motion that we do that.
I'll second it.
And second, thank you. Linda?
In favor.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition? Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. And a financial update. What, you're still just standing there like you're waiting on somebody to finish.
I
have to check y'all first before you get to talk again.
I completely understand. I'm here today now to provide our financial update for the first 9 months of our fiscal year. As you can see, our percent change from the budget as it has been amended or adopted for 15-16 is 2.36%, so not quite as much change as we had during fiscal year 14-15. Revenues, we have collected 86% of our budget as opposed to 82% from the previous fiscal year, and overall our revenues are up 9.3%. Expenditures, we are at 70% of our budget has been expended versus 71% from where we were this time 14-15. And the last slide kind of gives you just an example of where we are, revenues over expenditures with our other financing sources. And our net effect right now is $15.3 million in revenues over expenses. Compare that to where we were at this time for 14-15 at $14.2 million. So if anyone has any questions.
Did you say this was 9 months?
Yes, sir.
And is there anything in the last 3 months that you see that might change the course that we're on now?
What we will see through the course is we have, actually today, we will have one more big debt service payment in about $2.8 million. So for our debt service, that will now have had all of our costs incurred there. And we'll see just revenues right now, the biggest stream that we're seeing is sales tax. So that is all dependent on consumer spending. So we could see it continue to increase, or if the market starts drifting back, then we would see that number decline.
Right. And most of the property taxes,
yes, most collected. Of the property tax has been collected. I think right now we are at 98% that we've collected for our property tax.
With that being said, I would like to thank Jeremy, our tax administrator, for the fine job you're doing. And I think the citizens need to recognize that. I mean, I know I hate paying my taxes, but it's what we have to do. And he has done a good job doing that and working to get the collections in, which is our source of main source of revenue. And without that, we don't operate. And thank you, Jeremy, very much for your dedication. I see him a lot of nights when I come to commissioner meetings at night, and he'll be in there when we come, and sometimes there when we leave. So. I appreciate that, sir.
I've got a question.
Yes, sir.
I think you said, didn't you say year to year revenue is up 9% as
yes,
compared
sir.
To last year? Now, how's expense is, and what's the percentage of expense increase year to year?
For our expenses, we have seen that we are actually.
Not know what percentage growth expense was.
Right. It's $4 million above where we were at this point in time last year. So less than 10%.
So they're both increasing at the same rate, I guess.
Fairly close.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And with that, I don't guess we need to make any motions to approve it or do anything. Thank you for that update, and we look forward to hearing a lot more here in the next month or so at our budget hearings. So. She got her homework to do. All right. Stepping Up Initiative, Commissioner Byrd, and I think the sheriff, or you, who wants to speak first?
Let me give her an update on our trip, but just to remind everybody that last, I forget when it was, last summer, I think, August maybe, the Board of Commissioners approved a resolution as part of a nationwide effort, and the resolution was to set up a task force to help us as a community to deal with reducing the number of people with severe mental illness in our jails. And the sheriff is 100% behind this. He's been kind of after this issue for a long time, and now he's real pleased that we have this organized effort to do it. So part of our resolution was to commit, if we had the opportunity, to attend this national summit that was going to be held this spring, and it was held a couple of weeks ago, and I'd like to make a report about that summit. This was in Washington, D.C., April 17th through the 19th. So this initiative, as well as a summit, was sponsored by the National Association of Counties, which represents county commissioners and county managers all across the country, the American Psychiatric Association Foundation, and they're involved because of the mental health piece, and then the Council of State Governments Justice Center, and they're involved because of the justice reform aspects of this issue. So I looked it up today. So far, there are 263 Stepping Up counties in the United States, and those counties represent one-third of the U.S. population. 200 of those counties, there are 23 North Carolina counties that are a part of this, and so we're one of those 23, and they include the counties around us, Orange, Guilford, Durham, Rockingham, Wake, and Forsyth counties. 200 of those 263 counties across the country applied. It was a competitive application to attend this summit, and only 50 were chosen, and we were one of those 50. And we were chosen because of the promise that we showed to really making a difference in our community. So those who attended, and this is all expense paid by the sponsors, mostly the American Psychiatric Association's Foundation, were Craig Honeycutt, our county manager, Susan Osborne, our director of DSS, Chief Deputy Sheriff Tim Britt, thank you Tim, Robin Huffman, who's the Executive Director of the North Carolina Psychiatric Association, and Robin lives in Burlington, so she's a local person, and then myself. And when we were there, we actually were seated at the same table as Pitt County, which was the only other North Carolina county that attended this summit. So the objective of the summit was to guide attendees in developing a system-level plan to reduce the number of people with mental illnesses in their jails. So this is more than a law enforcement issue, it's more than a criminal justice issue. They really emphasize this is a community issue because it includes so many different components of our community, including the mental health system, the judicial system, law enforcement, our jail officials, affordable housing is part of this, employment is part of this. And of course, it really impacts the individuals that have mental illness that are incarcerated and their families. So we heard from a lot of great speakers at this conference. One of the most impressive to me was Judge Steve Leifman, who is a judge with the 11th Judicial Circuit Court in Miami-Dade County. He's an award-winning judge because of the pioneering efforts that he's had with jail diversion efforts for those with mental illness and lower level crimes. But we have the gamut of political spectrum from Senator John Cornyn of Texas, who's on the extreme right side, I guess, of the political fence, to U.S. Senator Al Franken from Minnesota, who's kind of on the extreme left side of the fence. But just to show you how bipartisan this is, the Los Angeles District Attorney Jackie Lacey was there, and the Los Angeles, I forget what the exact numbers are, but Los Angeles County is bigger than a lot of states in the United States, and just a ton of municipalities, so it's a huge issue for them, but they're one of these pioneering counties in this issue. We have the senior advisor to President Obama, Valerie Jarrett, to speak. Bexar County, Texas Sheriff Susan Pamerlau, boy, she was real impressive. This is San Antonio, Texas, and she's a retired U.S. Air Force Major General. And she's really interested in this because of her brother having bipolar disease. Their jail is the 16th largest in the nation. They have 4,000 inmates, and 800 of those inmates have mental illness. We had a former Washington Post reporter and author of this award-winning book called Crazy. His name is Pete Early, and the book is about his son who had bipolar disease and was in and out of jail a lot. He's now stable and working in a jail diversion program. The Ohio Commissioner for Mental Health and Substance Abuse, now this is the commissioner under John Kasich, another political leader. Her name is Tracy Plouk, and the efforts that the state of Ohio is doing there. The Deputy U.S. Attorney General, U.S. Attorney General, Sally Yates. So she's number two behind the Attorney General from Greensboro. We had a panel discussion moderated by PBS host Cokie Roberts. You've probably all heard of Cokie Roberts. With three stars and the award-winning original Netflix show called Orange is the New Black. And has anybody seen that? I haven't seen that. But this show apparently is one of the most highly watched shows on Netflix, and it depicts the life in the minimum security women's prison and all the circumstances around being incarcerated. So what we learned was several things, but first of all, the summit was really organized or framed with six questions for county leaders, and those are, is leadership committed? And I think we have good committed leadership in Alamance County. Do we conduct timely screening and assessments? Probably have a lot more work to do there. Tim, would you say? Do we have baseline data? And probably the real truth is that we don't yet. We're working on that. Do we conduct a comprehensive process analysis and inventory of services? Well, this is a big need, and this is something that we've learned that's a lot harder to do than what you might think, to figure out what we have in the community to help address this and where are the gaps. Have we prioritized policy, practice, and funding improvements? And do we track progress? So I guess I would characterize what we learned as just how important this issue is nationally and the bipartisan support that it has and leadership all across this country. We got a little bit deeper dive into what's called the sequential intercept model, and that's a model where you look at all the places where somebody that's going through the system from the time before they're arrested to the time that they're arrested and then incarcerated and when bond is set, and then what happens once they're in jail and what kind of planning should be done when they're released from jail. These are all called intercept points. So we learned more about those. We learned about a lot of best practices. One of them is to set up diversion centers. Now these diversion centers go by a variety of names. Some communities call them restoration centers. Some call them assessment centers or crisis centers. Another component for successful counties is to have really strong crisis intervention training, or CIT, and for more than just law enforcement officers, but there's a lot more that we can do in this community around that. A lot of communities have specialty courts, and I'm talking about like mental health court, drug court, veterans court, because a lot of these people are actually veterans, juvenile court, DWI court, so different communities do it differently, but all that has an impact on diverting people with mental illness out of the jails. Some use mental health probation officers. Some utilize co-responders, where there's a mental health professional that accompany or law enforcement officers as they go out and make these initial calls when incidents happen. We learn more about screening tools and assessment tools and conducting community gaps analysis. So we heard the experiences of several pioneering counties, including big counties, little counties. Miami-Dade County in Florida was a big pioneer county. Bexar County in Texas. Franklin County, Pennsylvania, that's a county much smaller. Los Angeles County, Maricopa County, Arizona, Allegheny County, Pennsylvania, and many, many more. And we learned about grant opportunities that are available to counties. From the Bureau of Justice Assistance, which is part of the Department of Justice. They provide grant money to help counties do this kind of work and other kinds of justice work. There's a foundation in Texas called the Meadows Foundation. So that's what we learned, and we were kind of thinking on the way back, we all traveled together, what our next steps would be, and we need to reconvene our task force. We have a pretty large task force that's working on a lot of these elements. We definitely want to pursue grant opportunities for both planning and implementation of some of these strategies. There's just a lot of work that needs to be done, and it would be helpful to have some funding to do some of these and have some staff to do some of these too. So we'll probably be coming back at the next meeting of this board for approval for a grant application. We want to explore the feasibility of a diversion center and other diversion strategies that I just mentioned. This might be a good use of that Canoro Clinic building that we've been talking about, perhaps. I think we need to do some work as just how much space a diversion center for the county of our size would need and see if that matches up and all that. And we talked about building a field trip up to Buncombe County, which is a stepping up county. And apparently they've done, they weren't at the meeting, but they've done a lot of work. And I think, Sheriff, you have some connections up there that can help arrange us to go up and see what they're doing. But I think we all came away really happy that we got to go. We were presented, there was a jam-packed full 2 days of sessions and workshops. And but we came back very energized to want to continue to do this work. So that's my report. And Tim, would you like to add anything, or Craig, since both of you came?
Sure, I would just like to add that my takeaway would certainly be we can do this. We can do this in Alamance County. We got some really good ideas. We got to see some of the pitfalls. And what I'm excited about, this is that whole political perspective too, left, right. Just kidding, we're on board here, but what we can really do is I think we can do good for our community, we can save some money, and we can just do the right thing by some people that are falling through the cracks and are doing life sentences 30 days at a time across the street.
Right.
Because they're not getting treatment for their mental health issues. So I concur. Thank you, Mr. Bird. Thanks for the opportunity to go.
Thank you. Very good.
Sure.
Sheriff, you got any?
Yes, sir.
I know you got something you want to
add. I do, because I'm going to tell you something. I am elated that the stepping up issue is taking place right here in Alamance County. Why? I was elected sheriff December 1st, 2002. Immediately saw what was happening in our detention center and the cost it was to our citizens in Alamance County. Same people over and over. I am the largest agency, mental health agency in Alamance County. And if you don't believe me, I will take you over to the jail and show you some of the problems. Folks, we talk about it's going to cost money. Well, right now it's probably average cost us probably around $50 a day to hold an inmate. Okay, that's not counting the meds that we have to give them, which is extremely high. National average shows us between 17 and 20% of the inmates in any jail has severe mental illness. 17% of our 476 inmates at our jail would be 81 inmates. At $50 a day keeping them, that's $4,050 $28,350 a week, $1,474 a year. That we could be saving, but the big issue is these people are ill. We can help them if we can keep them on the right path and get them their medications. They won't be back in that jail. Another issue is that a study was done in 2005 by UNCG of the Alamance County Detention Center, taking in consideration that mental illness, the 17% is severe mental illness, not the drug-related illnesses and alcohol-related illnesses. They said 40% was the population of the Alamance County Jail. That means 190 inmates at 40%. You're looking at $3,458 a year if that jail is full. And believe me, it has stayed full up until just recently. And these are individuals that could be productive citizens in society if we were to give them the treatment necessary. We're not able to access medical records of some people coming in jail because of the HIPAA law. We don't know what some of the people, the mental illness they have. And if we did, you'd see that number increase, probably. Inmates that come into the detention center, many of them are on Medicaid. The minute they enter those doors, guess what? Medicaid stops. If we had a diversion unit that could deal with some of these issues,
the Medicaid could pay instead of the taxpayer paying. A lot of these individuals could return back into society and not wind back up in the county jail on a weekly basis. Secondly, our deputies sometime in the past, it's gotten a whole lot better, when we pick up an individual on mental illness papers, we have to carry them to the hospital. Used to, we had some deputies that had to stay 24, 36 hours waiting for a doctor to see them. That takes an officer off the street too, plus costs the taxpayers more money. Also, there is a great liability for me as sheriff and the county for people going into the detention facility that has mental illnesses, wind up hanging themselves or killing themselves. That is a big liability. But the shame is that we have turned our back on the mental illness in this nation, state, and county for years. And I've been in law enforcement for 44 years, and for 44 years I have seen that happening, and it is sickening, commissioners, when we could be helping people. I agree with what you say. The county has several unused buildings. I am sure one of those buildings could be looked at and developed into a diversity unit or a restoration unit, and Alamance County can help the citizens that are mentally ill here. Help them return to society and not to the Alamance County Jail. And if any of you believe I am stretching the truth, spend Friday and Saturday night with me at the Alamance County Jail and you will see. Commissioners, I ask that you look at this problem. And I ask that we do something about this problem. Because it is up to you. Government is supposed to look after our people. You are government. I am government. Mr. Honeycutt's government. We have for years turned our back on it. And it's time to be heard. And this county has the ability to be a model for the United States with the leadership we have and with the people that are interested in it and wanting to see this come about. And I'm one of them, Commissioner Burke.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sheriff, give him, I think he deserves applause for that.
I'd like to thank the sheriff for those words of support and encouragement.
Yes.
Thank you, Sheriff. And I'd also like to thank Susan Osborne, because Susan and I are co-chairing this task force. But Susan's really doing all the work, and she's doing a masterful job at keeping us energized and organized, and she made a lot of logistical arrangements for our transportation to Washington, and she's just doing a great job.
I got a question. I heard the word grants. There's some grant availability. Who is, I guess Susan is kind of the point person to work through that.
We're working on that now. There's a couple of grants through the Department of Justice that is the civil side, not the
sheriff's side.
Not the sheriff's side. But we are working on those applications now, and we will present those to the board at our next meeting for approval. Susan has done a masterful job on this, and we've talked a lot of different options, and one of the things that I want to make sure the board is okay with, there was some concern about using the Cronodal building as another option for inspections and using it for planning and property addressing. So we're going to delay that at this moment until we know exactly what we want to do, if that is okay with the board. So I don't want to start down a process with some architects. We actually had sent out requests for qualifications to architects. To begin looking at the process for some remodeling, just for part of it, but we'll stop that process until we decide definitively what we want to do with the Cronodal building, if that's okay with the board.
I think it's a great thing. Sheriff, do you have any statistics of the veterans that are revolving door into your jail?
I don't have them here, but I can.
That would be an interesting number, because
the amount of those returning from Afghanistan.
I know there's a lot of issue with the PTSD issues, and they went and protected us. I think we owe them a whole lot.
Absolutely.
We heard of one process at this conference where in certain counties, they've gotten together, they've gotten all the social services agencies together, like the health department, the sheriff's department, the mental health facilities, and so on, to, for everybody shared, who are their top 25 users of their facilities? And it's amazing how much in common of those top 25 zero in, just prioritize the individuals who are using these kinds of services, including the jail, you can really make some inroads. So that's something we might want to, an exercise we might want to do in this county too.
Well, and also, if we look at the model, we've been very successful with Family Justice Center as a model to bring people together under one roof, and that would kind of be very similar to what we would do with that intake center as well.
Well, I'm glad you brought the Family Justice up. I think we set an example for a lot of the state in dealing with that issue and bringing that to fruition, because everybody's willing to work together and nobody really cared where the credit went. Right. And that sounds like we're doing the same thing here. And from my point of view, I think we need to move forward. And
we will.
Okay. So, I don't think we can take a vote on anything, but we'll at least give a consensus on it.
The vote will be at our next meeting. We are spending a little bit of money right now on consultants trying to get this application in, because we are in a very, very tight time frame. But we feel like we have a very good shot of getting help with the plan grant, but also with implementation as well. And again, I want to thank the sheriff and Tim for their support, but again, another big thanks to Susan, who has really taken on a leadership role on this, like she has nothing else to do with the Department of Social Services. But she and Robin Huffman have truly been a champion on this, and also thanks to Commissioner Burke.
Yeah,
as well.
Thanks for bringing this into action and for pushing it forward. Very good.
All right. No, I'm very serious about it, because I'm paying for two positions to help get this off the budget.
And we're going to see if we can't get you the money to
get blood out of a turnip. you have done something, and you know that the turnip's worth cooking.
There you go. All right. Well, very good. So thank you, Commissioner Byrd, Tim, Sheriff. Thank you very much. And appreciate what y'all have done so far, and look forward to a lot of other good stuff coming out of that. All right. Well, looks like the sheriff might be up again. Budget amendment for the jail.
Yes, sir. There's a couple of them, and this is right along the line of what we've been talking about. We had a bill around $130,000 that was not paid in the last budget. We're having to move money over to pay it, simply because of some of the stuff we're talking about right here, is money for the medical in the jail. And we're asking that money be transferred to contracted service 4320440. Is that right?
That's correct.
All right, that's what you're talking about.
Second, yes, sir.
Well, I was going to suggest that you might describe, because I learned a lot with Tim, and I've heard you talk about this too, just some of the line items that we spend in the jail for the actual medical, I mean, some of those medical costs. You mentioned the drugs, for example, for the mentally ill, but it's other things too that we're paying.
There's a tremendous amount of other things in that jail, especially when you're dealing with the medical facility and also, you know, your mental health patients, a ton of different things.
Do we need to do this on separate?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, we need to separate those out. Okay. More questions about the jail amendment? That I'll take a motion to approve.
Move to approve.
Thank you, Roger.
I second.
Thank you, Linda. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, very good. Now you get to go.
Get to go again. I have asked that $7,903 be moved from one line item, which actually is state and federal drug seized assets, and another $6,506 into a line item to purchase two vehicles. A total of $14,409 will be transferred. These are drug monies that have been seized by my agency in drug investigations. And why are we looking to buy two vehicles now? First of all, we need them. Second of all, we were able to get the, or able to get these two vehicles, something like $10,000 to $12,000 cheaper because they were setting, they were 2015s, they were already fully equipped with blue lights, and normally it takes us to fully equip a car about $42,000 per car. So we were able to get these at $30,000-some, $31,000.
It's a good negotiation going on there.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Craig has been beating me pretty hard.
So this was, these are being purchased according to the proper procedures and everything.
That's what we are all good.
Everybody's good, manager's fine with that, and finance director with that, I'll take a motion to approve, and if there's no other.
I move we approve it.
I'll second it.
Second, thank you, Linda. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No opposition, thank you.
Sheriff, did you want to mention your drug forfeiture release?
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Of course, the check's in the mail. Always here. Check's in the mail from the federal government, so who knows, but supposedly we are entitled within the next 6 weeks to $350,000 that we had seized
years ago
before DOJ decided to jump on me, and they are turning that money loose, plus there's another $900,000 that we will get a fairly decent chunk of that money, and then there's some others that, of course, I have all the sheets that's been put in, and I assure you there's substantial more that's supposed to be coming
right,
if they do it right. But like I say, all I know is the checks in the mail is what they see.
Well, I think we owe some gratitude to our congressman, yes. Walker.
Absolutely.
And us push this forward. They were stalemating for a long, long time, and he got to asking questions, and I think
if
changed
you
some attitude.
Could see the video of Congressman Walker getting on to the, I think it's number two man with ice, you'll understand why they turned it loose.
Right.
That's all I'm going to say.
All right. Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. County Manager, what you got to talk to?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple of things I do want to mention. And again, as I told Mr. Parker earlier, we're filling up his calendar. May 2nd, if you want to be here, but we're going to do this especially for Mr. Parker. We're going to have department heads come in and make a very quick 5 to 10 minute presentation to Mr. Parker, and so he can start putting names with faces and departments, and so if he needs any additional information, we'll be glad to help him. So that should be about 2 to 4, 2 to 5, along with that time frame on Wednesday. And Ms. Parker, I told you I was going to get him out your hair, so we'll stay busy. The other thing I do want to give you is this is our tentative schedule for the budget, which is the week of next week, beginning next week, May 9th. There may be some conflicts, and I'll make sure that the judge gets one of these as well. But if this works, we can finalize this in the time frame. If not, we can drop back and punt and see what we need to do. I know Commissioner Byrd may have had some concerns on Thursday.
My biggest concern was Thursday afternoon, if there'd be any way to move those, but I don't see a lot of opportunity unless they got moved to a morning somewhere. But Eddie, I think you had a problem with
morning.
If you
can put it off to the next week, I'll be done with my class on 13th. So if we can move it to the next week, I could do, you know, morning or afternoon. If
we want to look at the 16th,
that would
move Thursday to the 16th.
That would work.
That'd be good on
the
16th.
Works for everyone else. Yeah. Yeah, I can do morning or afternoon then. So it's up to you guys.
Yeah. But yeah, well, that's our board of commissioners meeting. So
that'd be a night. So.
Oh, board of VNR is in here. I'm sorry.
Okay.
You want to go Tuesday? We'll go to the 17th.
Can the ENR board, that's how big is, that's a small board.
Yeah, I think we may go to the 17th since ENR is in here that same day. May 17th, is that okay with everyone?
There is that community college groundbreaking.
What time is that?
That's it. I have it at 2:30.
Yeah. Okay, why don't we do the 17th in the morning, if that's okay with you guys?
Yeah, that'd be great. Or what about the 16th in the morning? You can do that, too?
I could do the morning of the 16th also.
Could we?
That's fine. What time's the board of E&R meeting?
Jeremy, you know, are they starting at 8?
I think it's a certain 9 o'clock.
Okay, well, let's do the 17th then.
Okay. 17th, and that's we'll fine. Do it in the morning, 9 o'clock.
All right.
Well, thank you for making that accommodation.
Yeah, that'll work, because I'm done on 13th.
Can you meet here?
Yep, meet here in the commissioner room.
So that will be the one scheduled for Thursday afternoon will be moved to Tuesday morning.
To the 17th.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. And then speaking of the 17th that you have already mentioned, is the groundbreaking for the Career Tech Center at the community college at 2:30. I would suggest probably getting there around 2. You know, there should be a lot of people over there, and but there shouldn't be any classes going on during that time. So, but that groundbreaking will be then. Also, if the board is aware, as part of County Government Month last month, we did County Government 101. We had 2 sessions, and I want to thank Tori for all her help in helping organizing that. We actually had very good attendance both sessions, and we had morning sessions and we had evening sessions. But I also want to thank Stacy with the health department, the sheriff with the sheriff's department, Adrian and Kelly with DSS, and Libby with strategic plan. They both gave, or they all gave presentations as well. So do want to thank everybody. I thought it went really, really well. We're going to try to expand that maybe in the fall to like a 5 to a 10 session, so we can travel to the landfill, we can travel to the social services, we can go to the jail, so people can really get a good feeling of what we do. But there's thanks to Scott also. Scott has put a County Government 101 website or on our webpage, and we videotaped it, so it really turned out well. So good. We appreciate all the help. Okay. And that is all I have.
All right. Sounds great. All right. The next order of business, public speakers. And we had one, Mr. Cox. Welcome to come forward.
You know, I can't get my mind around this deal about these planning board members not being sworn an oath. But, hey. Question to us is always, well, what you got to hide? I seen in recently Parliament over there across the pond, one of the longest sitting chair or members of Parliament called David Cameron Dodgy Dave over some money he supposedly had hid down there in Panama. And the chairman, order, and they remove him. But didn't nobody forcibly remove him? I didn't see nobody with guns around him. I didn't see no votes to bar him from meetings or speaking. But hey, that's over there. Constitutions are a funny thing. You know, 2007, Deborah Prince, Alamance County Planning Department received multiple complaints that suggest you may operate in a junkyard that is in violation of the Alamance County High Impact Land Use, including industries ordinance. That was the lie. That's where the lie started, right there. But who cares, right? Them people over there in that jail, they can't get help. When they come out of that jail, oh no, you can't get a job. No. We can get grant money though. We can enforce schemes to whom it may concern. The Alamance County Tax Department only has license for beer and wine and fortune telling. We don't carry any other license at the present time. But that's okay, right? As long as it don't affect me. All I ever asked was admission of wrongdoing. Apologize, and what can we do to make it right? That's all I ever said. We know that Jason Martin was a liar. Proved it. He proved it himself. I wouldn't believe what your county attorney said. I don't care what it is. Prove it. I'm sorry. I wish it wasn't like that. I'm sorry. The plumbing licensing people down there in 2014 said something.
Thank you, Tony. All right. Commissioner responses?
Well, I'd just like to say one comment about the due process. I mean, I'm all in favor of due process. I think we have some due process and with respect to the planning board because, I mean, everything, they only make recommendations right. to us, and it's and whatever they are recommending is vetted by our county attorney. Is that right?
It goes through county attorney. If there's questions, they help write the change ordinance, not ordinance, but any like this with the representation for the different communities to make sure everybody's represented. That was part of the process. Ben was in on that with Libby working through that. And
are there any other examples of like entities of county government taking an oath of office, any other committees or?
Well, there's a statute that sets forth what offices are subject to taking an oath. And I can provide you with a copy of that.
I know on the Board of Health we take an oath, but that's a separate board. I mean, that's not, even
it's
though
not we're. Not under the county government. Right,
right. Right.
Yeah. I know the clerk of court takes an oath, the register of deeds takes an oath.
Well, and they're in the
elected officials.
Yeah, they're elected. Right.
The Board of Commissioners sits as a quasi-judicial body when it hears appeals from a planning board decision, which your decision is appealable to the Court of Appeals in Raleigh. So there's always a
same with tax level. And everything else.
It, that's correct.
There's another step if people want to appeal it. So, all right, very good. Any other comments? Okay, with that, we will go into closed session, and I will make the motion. I move that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board and receive a report regarding the claims made in the case entitled Triumph LLC versus Alamance-Caswell LME. And I make that motion, and if I can hear a second.
I'll second.
Thank you, Linda. With that, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and we shall go into closed session. Having gone into closed session, I will entertain a motion to come out of closed session.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Roger, thank you. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All right. Well, for the press or whoever's left, nobody's left, it looks like. So the board considered and gave instructions to it.
Huh?
Oh, I know. The board has considered and gave instructions to the county attorney concerning a response to the settlement offer in the case of Triumph LLC and Alamance County local managed entity. I got that wrong, didn't I? Anyhow, and if you have questions, we will let the county attorney answer those and fill you in on what was discussed there and let you know where we're heading with that. So, thank you very much. And with that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay. Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. We're done.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Who is making this?
Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.